Prince Harry, the Duke of Sussex's new memoir, is officially on sale around the world. While most of the attention is focused on palace intrigue and the royal's family dynamic, some mental health professionals have remarked on the pain and grief detailed in the prince's book. Prince Harry opened up on interviews with 60 Minutes Sunday about the loss of his mother, and again last night on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert about the loss of his late grandmother, Queen Elizabeth II.
I am now, and I was then, genuinely happy for her because she finished life. She had an amazing life, she had an amazing career, and she was buried with her husband.
You know, you're 12 years old, sort of 7:30 in the morning, early. Your father comes in, sits on your bed, puts his hand on your knee, and tells you there's been an accident. I couldn't believe.
The prince is facing backlash for telling his story, and some say oversharing family details that should have stayed private. Now we are glad to welcome in Dr. Goodman to speak about all of this, a clinical psychologist. You work with both children and adults who have experienced trauma and loss. Dr. Robin Goodman, thank you very much for taking some time to talk to us this morning.
Oh, thanks for having me.
I wondered if we could ask you about whether you were surprised by any of the revelations in the prince's book about his upbringing and his reaction to losing his mother, Princess Diana.
No, I haven't read the book, but I've seen and heard him talking about this. And none of it surprises me, really, in terms of working with so many children that have had this experience in terms of, you know, the death of a parent or someone important. Especially, you can see, it's so interesting, you can see the difference between a grandmother who was older, you knew that she was in her last days or years of her life, versus when it's a very sudden, tragic, traumatic, and surprising death. You have the potential for having, you're at risk for many more difficulties when that's the situation.
You just mentioned it. Thousands of people, adults and children, experience grief and loss every year. The past few years have been especially difficult. Is the prince's reaction similar to how others react to deep loss?
Yes, it's so great to know. Over 200,000 kids under the age of 18 lost a parent or a primary in-home caregiver. And every year, you know, we know that 1 in 13 kids by the age of 18 will have lost a parent or sibling. So it's really more common. It's not just a royal problem. What you see is, you know, we expect kids to be sad. They may grieve in bursts. Sometimes they look happy. And so maybe you think they're doing okay. And then their grief evolves over time where they adjust to the loss. Well, you see with Prince Harry and other kids that have experienced a traumatic situation sometimes, not all of them, most recover, but there are those that may have more traumatic reactions. And there's very specific kinds of things we see. Some is that they have intrusive thoughts or nightmares, and then you see the kids are not sleeping and you may not understand why. They may have trouble concentrating, and they also may have physical complaints. Again, you don't really know what they're coming from because it's their whole system is upset. They may be sad, isolated, withdrawing from different things. And those are the kinds of things you want to keep an eye on, because what happens is this traumatic event is maybe stuck in their mind. They have triggers that remind them of what happened. And so then they don't engage in those healthy, maybe positive memories and activities with people around them to help them adjust.
You know, I wanted to ask you about this. Prince Harry describes his brother Prince William's reaction as being very different from his own. How does that play out? And have you seen that before?
Yeah, you know, it's really surprising because not only is the event what's important, but it's also your previous experiences, your own mental health, your learning, your age, and just also, you know, where you are in your life sometimes. There also is no right or wrong way. And sometimes it's how you perceive the situation or perceive the events, as well as, you know, you can look very different. So one kid may be very sad and kind of isolated and withdrawn, and the other one is trying to cover that up by being, you know, really a super, being extra responsible. Now, I'm not saying which they were, but we often see in the same family, the same situation, tremendous different. One may be expressing much more of the feelings outwardly, and one may be expressing the feelings much more inwardly, but they both have tremendous feelings about the grief and the person that died.
And oftentimes you come in to treat or help people who've experienced loss. Tell us about that, and especially when it comes to children.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, there's so much that people can do. It starts with the adults, because it's not only the event, but it's also the people around them. It's their reactions to the event. It's what the kids remember, or because they're so overwhelmed, they might be numb, they might be avoiding those feelings. But the adults and how they model coping, how they talk to kids, how they help them express and validate what's going on, leave the door open. This is adults, parents, teachers, all the people that are in contact in the world of that child have tremendous ability to help. And then for a smaller percentage of kids, there's some science-based, evidence-based work and therapies that help, especially when it's a traumatic experience, where what you do is you help kids learn strategies to feel calmer, to then express what there's in their mind in a very, with the guidance of someone that can help them with that. And then what happens is they learn how to cope with the different feelings, because these are lifelong things. There's no right or wrong way, and there's no stages. It's okay when these things happen, you have these feelings. What can you do? How can you manage? Is it breathing? Is it distracting? Is it connecting with friends or family? Is it doing something athletic to help yourself? So there's so many things that you can do that really help kids wherever they are in this process.
Clinical psychologist Dr. Robin Goodman, thank you so much for being with us this morning.